very good morning. Welcome to Kapp CFE classroom. Our today's topic is very relevant topic for us as a fraud investigator. Whatever investigation we have done so far, this particular topic is the core of it. And the name of this topic is report writing. We understand that as a fraud investigator, we have certain tasks to perform, which includes obtaining the evidence, testimony, helping the client with prevention and detection, and then reporting. So whatever investigation we have done as an expert or as a fraud examiner, we have to write a report for it, and then we have to submit either to our client or it might also go to the court. We have to really be clear and particular about this task of ours, which is called report writing. The more practical and nice report you make, the more successful you will be in this career of fraud examination. Let's try to understand what kind of reports do we write. So there are two reports which we as a fraud investigator may write. One, fraud investigation report, and secondly, expert report. The fraud examination report is a report which is being written by anybody from our team in fraud examination. So when we have done some kind of fraud examination for our client, we can write this report. The better you write this fraud examination report, it entirely depends that what was the spectrum of your fraud investigation and how nicely you have completed your fraud investigation. If the first part needs to be really strong, fraud examination techniques needs to be very crisp, and then only you'll be able to write a nice fraud investigation report. This report can be written by anybody from our fraud investigation team, basis the facts, evidences, what we have collected during our investigation, and so on. The second type of report is called expert report. It may possible that sometime the judge, jury, attorney, or the client may be looking for certain expert opinion, and that's where we can write a report called expert report. As the name suggests, in this report, expert give his own opinion about a technical matter. There may be a lot of cases where this expert report may be part of fraud examination report also. So every time we write expert report, there has to be a separate subject and a separate report. So if you have to give opinion on three technical matter, my recommendation, please write three expert reports separately. It may be attached along with the fraud examination report, but again, these are two different reports. So there has to be certain fraud examination technique and the report, and then expert opinion report along with that particular fraud examination report. So both the cases can be done by us as a CFE. We can simply write fraud examination report. We can also write expert report, depending on the situation and depending on the need. Whatever report we make, whether it's an expert report or as a fraud examination report, we need to keep it in mind that this report might go in the court. Even if your client has no intention at the moment to take it to the court, please remember the litigation might follow. Why we need to keep this point in mind? That if it will go in court, it will be cross-examined. And every single piece of information and evidence what you have written in the report will be cross-examined. So please be 100% sure what you are writing in the report and how relevant it is to the case. As a fraud investigator, you might have used source and informant for your work. You may. But unless and until you are 100% sure about their information and you have cross-checked it, please do not make it part of your report. If they will prove to be wrong, your credibility will be come under question mark. So that is where we need to be careful. Now, when we understood there are two types of report we can make, fraud examination report and expert report, a good report needs to have certain characteristics. The first, it has to be accurate. When we say accurate, that means it includes all relevant evidences and those evidences should be true to the greater extent of what you believe. Do not just put anything in your report which you are not sure of or you are not verified. It will be very, very risky for us to do anything of such sort. So we call that accuracy. The second point or second characteristic is called clarity. Our fraud investigation report needs to be very, very clear. If you are writing anything which is in technical in nature, try to explain in the simpler manner. Judge or attorney may not be a technical person like us. So you have to be very, very clear as to what do you want to convey through this. The third is called timeline. Try to write your report as close to the event as you can. When you take interview or you try to collect evidences, with course of time, the suspect or the witnesses might forget. It is always relevant for us to write the report as early as we can. So timeline is very, very important, an important aspect of a report. Then comes the evidences. Whatever evidences you are putting in the report, you need to be unbiased. As a fraud investigator, our task is not to filter as to what to write, what not to write. Our task is to present all the facts which seems to be material to the case. We are not attorney. Our task is not to make our client win or lose. So we have to be unbiased, impartial, and putting all the evidences which are relevant in the report. So these are certain characteristics which a good report might have. Now, once we understand, there are some more things which we have to remember while writing the report. There has to be clarity in terms of how you are writing the report, the spelling mistakes. Now, let's try to understand the structure of the report, as to what kind of structure can we give it to the report. Not always that we have to be very, very particular about this structure, but it is a recommended structure when we write a report. The first part of our report includes background. The background of the report should be approximately 2 paragraphs. Again, depending on the circumstances, but roughly as a thumb rule, it has to be for 2 paragraphs. The purpose of writing this background is to, why did we start this investigation? Did we get any call? Did we got any kind of tip? Or client has approached us for this? So this is what we have to write in our background paragraph. Post background, we move to the another heading called executive summary. The executive summary is quite a relevant heading, which includes what was the outcome of the investigation. So you have to summarize as to what did you perform in the company and what was the outcome of it. Thumb rule, it has to be 1 pager. So executive summary needs to be really, really crisp and summarized manner of whatever you have done. The third heading of the report calls scope. This scope needs to be really, really clearly defined. What all areas did you cover in your investigation? This can also be very crucial for future liabilities. If you want to restrict your liability, the scope can be very crucial for us. So please be very careful and clear what was the scope of the work. Post work, we move to another area which is called methodology. So methodology heading will tell us what did we perform. So how many people were there in your team? What kind of interviews did you perform? What are the people you have taken interview of, and so on. So we call that methodology. Post methodology, there is something called procedures. These procedures could be little detailed as to what exactly you did in the company. So when you took interview, how you took interview. If you have taken certain screenshot or some kind of dump from SAP or ERP, please include all those details here. So procedure needs to be detailed one. Once the procedure is done, we go for summary. Summary, in a very summarized or brief manner, tells what we did, what was the outcome of it. There's a difference between executive summary and summary. Executive summary broadly defines what we did, what was the outcome. Summary just summarize the work in a brief manner. Post summary, we can go for something called impact. Whatever impact was there in the company for this particular loss or the fraud, we have to write it as far as possible in numbers. If you can really find out the monetary loss, dollar loss, write it. Else, whatever impact you could understand, please write it in the impact column. It is important for the company to understand that single fraud incident will cause so much of impact on the company. And post-impact, there is something called recommendations. This recommendation is very, very crucial for us as an investigator. Our task does not just stop where we detect the fraud and tell our client that fraud has occurred. As we understand that our part of our job is also to help with the prevention. So please write the recommendations which are relevant to the case and practical. Try not to give theoretical knowledge here, rather give them practical solution of the problem as to how they can strengthen their internal controls. So that's about recommendations. This is a broad structure of the report. Setting do's and don'ts. Opinions. Unless you are writing expert report, you are not supposed to give your opinions. As far as possible, no. The opinion regarding guilt and innocence of a person is absolute no-no. It is against the code of conduct as per ACFE code of ethics. We are not supposed to give any opinion on guilt or innocence of a person. We are not a judge. Our task is to just present the evidences, not to conclude. So please avoid the opinions unless it's an expert opinion. Even if it is expert report, you are not supposed to give any opinion regarding guilt and innocence. Also, please avoid writing any kind of opinion or suggestion. For example, that suspect needs to be punished at least for 10 years. He should be behind the bars for 10 years. Please don't give such kind of suggestions also. The another thing which we should be careful is, as far as possible, do not write the name of suspect. If you have taken certain interview and you have taken a confession statement from a suspect, this confession statement speaks on its own. It doesn't require any conclusions. So as far as possible, conclusions should be avoided. If you've already got a confession from A, why do we need to conclude saying that as we have received a confession from A, hence we can say A is guilty? Now this line is unnecessary, not required. Once he has already given self-confession, it is self-explanatory, it speaks on its own. So please avoid those mistakes. It can also put you in the legal liability because the other person may sue you for defamation. So please avoid such things. If you have to really write somebody's about a suspect, try to write their designation, not the names. As far as possible, you can write assistant manager of purchase department might be involved in these cases, rather than writing A was involved in this case. The next point which I want to discuss here is about liability. Many times as a fraud investigator, we do not want to appear in the court. We don't want the third party to see our report. In that case, please write the disclaimer very, very clearly that this report is solely for internal purpose for management and it is not supposed to be shared to any third party. Once you write this statement, you have restricted your liability. So this liability inclusion should be there in the report if you really want to restrict your liability. If you don't, then your client can take it to the court anytime. If not client, any third party can drag it to the court. So if you really want not to appear in the court, please do include this liability phase also. Then question arises, who all can see your report? There can be a lot of people who can see your report. Could be a judge, jury, attorney, media, witness, cross-examining party, and so on. So there are a lot of people who will be looking at your report. We better be crisp and we better be particular about it. Some more things which we have to discuss about report is that there has to be strong verbs used in the report. Please do not use a lot of technical jargons in the report. As far as possible, write a report in a manner which is clearly able to understand. So some English language related or a particular language related rules you have to follow while making the report. So that's in nutshell about your chapter of report writing. And as I said, it's pretty important for us, our work, and also it is quite an important chapter for your CFA examination. So my suggestion to you guys, please read this chapter very carefully and try to have a writing of report which is very crisp and practical. That's all about this chapter. And I'll see you in next class with the new topic. Till then, stay tuned. Thank you so much.